Why don't you give?
Of Christ the Lord, bound to Him eternally by love's strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword, standing on the promises of God.
I'm standing.
Of God, my Savior, standing,
yes,
standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. I'm standing on the promises of God. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. And while you are standing, because it is our custom here to stand to honor the word of God, we are going to look at our responsive reading for today. Our responsive reading for the day is coming out of the epistle to the Galatians, looking at the third chapter. I am going to be reading the responsive reading, and then behind me is going to come Minister Dr. Etta Renee Johnson, and she will be reading the Galatians 5 text. So the responsive reading is coming out of Galatians, the third chapter, the 13th through the 26th verses. The 13th through the 26th verses, I'm going to begin. You will follow, and then we will all conclude with the 26th verse together. So it reads thusly: Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree.
That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith.
Brethren, I speak after the manner of men. Though it be but a man's covenant, yet if it be confirmed, no man disannulleth or addeth thereto.
Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith not, and to seeds as of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ.
All right. And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of God in Christ, the law, which was 430 years after, cannot disannul, that it should make the promise of none effect.
For if the inheritance be of the law, it is no more of promise. But God gave it to Abraham by promise.
Wherefore then serveth the law? It was added because of transgressions, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made. I really think I'd need to read that again.
Yes.
Till the seed should come to whom the promise was made.
Right.
And it was ordained by the angels in the hand of a mediator.
Now, a mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is one.
Is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law.
But the scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise made of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe.
But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed.
Wherefore, the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith.
But after that faith is come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster. Come on, let's read all together. For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus.
Amen. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's recite together the Lord's Prayer. Jesus taught his disciples to pray in this manner. He said, Our Father, which art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day
our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah. So if right now you will open up your book, turn to Galatians 5, and just walk with me through the 13th through the 18th verses.
Amen.
This text is identified with the heading, Stand Fast in Liberty. For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. Only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word. Even in this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. But if ye bite and devour one another, take heed that ye be not consumed one of another. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of God. Amen.
Amen. Ooh, how can I say thanks for the things you have done for me, things so unknown. to thee, to God be the glory, to God be the glory, to God be the glory for the things he has done with his blood. He has saved me with his power. He has raised me to God.
Done. With his blood, he has saved me. By his power, he has raised me. To God be all the glory for the things he has done. It was a year ago on this day that in this church, my beloved husband, his body was laid to rest on this very day. And so I thought it fit today to tell you when somebody asked me that I think I could stand and preach today. And I think it fitting for me to tell you that by the grace of God, I stand on the promise of God. Because in 1957, my husband and I collected our promise. God said that if we would believe in his son, Jesus Christ, we would be saved. God said that whether we live or whether we die, we would be in Christ. So on this day, actually on July the 20th, my husband stepped into eternal life. And I say with St. Timothy's today, to God be the glory for the things he has done. Standing on the promises of God, how can we say thanks to such a God as this?
Yes, Lord.
Who gave to undeserving sinners his only begotten son. I think if I were to ask you today to go down the checklist with me and say, count the promises that you have collected. The word of God says that he has given us precious, great, and precious promises. And I want to begin today. I want to begin in the third chapter of Galatians, because when we get there with Paul in chapter 3, he is basing his argument, he's basing his defense on the promise of God. And he can do that because God keeps his promises. Nobody can cancel his promises. The Bible says that all of his promises are yes and not no. And so today, I stand on the promises of God Almighty. In the light of the promises made to the Gentiles in this promise that Paul explains today, Paul calls the Galatians to the responsibility in the fifth chapter to stand in the liberty wherewith Christ has made them free. He has guaranteed them that they are free on the unfailing word of God. And it is in the third chapter of Galatians that he bases his defense on this promise. He is defending the truth of the word of God based on the promise of God made in the Old Testament in the book of Genesis. But before we go straight there, I just want to go here and say this to you, that Paul always defended the word of God. It was just in his nature. Early on, as he discussed the defense of the word of God in each one of his books, he made it very clear that he was defending the truth of God, the word of God. And so as we see him defending with this promise, we know that not only is he defending that promise, but he is defending even the words of God in John 3. In John 3, 16 and 17, where Jesus says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He defended every word of God, every truth of God. Jesus said Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Thank you. Hebrews 11:6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. This is the gospel. Mm-hmm. Titus 3:5-7 says, it is not by works of righteousness, right, which we have done, but according to God's mercy, he saved us by the washing of the regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. So it's by his power he has saved us. By his blood he has saved us. By his power he has raised us. To God be the glory for the great things he has done. So we've come through John and then to Romans, where Paul struggled with the formidable foe. I said to you then, struggle is good. Struggle prepares you to not only strengthen your physical your spiritual muscles, but it prepares you to help somebody else when they go through the struggle, because you've already been there. You've already been there. And so it helps you. So we've come that far with him. He was attacked by his own sin nature, and he described it. He had firsthand contact, firsthand experience with the struggle to stand against the wiles of the devil. And he knows what it takes to stand. You can't know how to help somebody else until you know what it means. You can't tell somebody what you've been through in grief until you know what it means to grieve. You can't tell somebody what it means to be broken in spirit until you've been broken. You can't tell somebody what it means to be shunned and ignored unless you've felt the pains of rejection. You can't tell somebody. This is why Isaiah said that Jesus can talk with us all about our troubles, because he was a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. They had hid, as it were, their faces against him. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. You got to go through a struggle before you can know how to help somebody get through a struggle. It takes pains to go through struggle. It takes questioning of yourself to get through the struggle. And this is what happened to the Apostle Paul. He had come through the sneak attacks of Satan and Satan's emissaries. And these people are still in the church of God today. He knew the importance of continuing in the very word of God. Saints, you cannot ignore the word of God. We must study to show ourselves approved unto God, workmen and women that need not be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of truth. We must meditate in his word day and night. Paul knew the living word of God, and he knew the written word of God, and he was fit for the fight. He honored God's word in everything he did. He honored God's word in Matthew 4:4, "The man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God that comes from the mouth of God." It was God's word he was defending. It was God's name he was defending. It was God's reputation he was defending. He was not trying, Deacon Davis, to make a name for himself. He was concerned about his God. It was God's sheep in Galatia that he was defending. That's what was at stake in these churches in Galatia. And that's really what we are called to do. 1 Peter 3:15 says, "Sanctify the Lord God in your hearts." In your hearts. That's the place where God ought to have first place. "And be ready always to give an answer to every man that asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, and do it with meekness and fear," because you'll be doing it with God's word, not yours. You'll be doing it out of God's wisdom, not yours. You'll be doing it out of the God, the Holy Spirit, out of His strength, not yours. That's the challenge today. And we can stand on the promises of God and carry out and confront and meet these challenges. You can stand if you let the Word of God dwell in you richly. You can't stand in your own strength. The Lord says, even as we are weak as I am right now, that He promised to be our strength. And I would say immediately, promise made, promise kept. Day and night, He is our strength. In sickness and in health, He is our strength. When nobody wants to be around us or be with us, He is our strength. He is our comforter. He is our keeper. We'll be ready to give an answer to defend the sacred word, the unadulterated truth of God Almighty, when we saturate our hearts and minds and souls with His word. The reason we can do that is because, you see, God really is able. And I have to refer to Deacon Taylor one more time, because in Vacation Bible School, he asked us about this, about being able to represent, about being ready to speak it out, about being able to do it on the instant, in a moment, when somebody called us to the task. And he said, we can do that. The Bible says we can do it. If we don't do it, it won't be God's fault, because God is able. He's able to do exceedingly abundantly anything we could ask or think. And at the right moment, he said, the Bible says at that very moment, when you're standing out there being questioned by the magistrates, when you're being held up to ridicule, when they think that they're going to cower you down, at that very moment, God will put the words in your mouth to say. God will put the right words in your mouth that will glorify Him. We can stand on that promise because He is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. He really is able. And so Paul was ready. Paul was ready. God's promises that he talks about in this chapter 3, he said they could never be revoked, canceled, or annulled. God's promises are sure and dependent. They are not laws, they are God's promises. They are not rules, they are His promises. They are not traditions, they are His promises. And He can perform what He promises. How many of you know He can perform what He promises? Do you have a testimony? Do you have a I'll bet you Marlene Zolikoff, if she could stand up right now, she would say, I've got a testimony. Because God performed a miracle in her life. It was in 1962 that Reverend Washington collected his promise from Psalm 91. God said, call on me, and I will answer you. When you get in trouble, call on me. I will answer you, and I will show you mighty, wondrous things. Do things for you that nobody else can do. Just call on Him, and He will answer. He ends chapter 2 with these words. He ends chapter 2 with these words. He says, I do not frustrate the grace of God. For if righteousness came by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. But because God does what He promises, the seed that He promised in Genesis 3:15 had to come. And for over 430 years, we stood on that promise. But then, when the fullness of time had come, sent His Son wrapped up in flesh, that promise had been kept. Promise made and a promise kept, says Dr. P.M. Smith. So Paul says, I will not frustrate the grace of God, because grace came through Jesus Christ. He has not died in vain. This is the kind of theological structure of the epistles of Paul. He never misses an opportunity to lay down the heavy truth of the Word of God, the heavy theology that does not call for people to shout, but calls for you to stand up for Jesus, to walk straight for Jesus, to speak up for Jesus, to honor God's Word, to walk in His way, and to honor the Holy Spirit. He emphasizes grace versus the law. The law came through Moses, but grace came through Jesus Christ. Grace, the very word, has the grand sound of freedom. Freedom from sin. Grace, God's riches at Christ's expense. Grace, freedom from the law. Grace, penalty paid. Grace, reconciliation with God. Grace, access to the throne of God's mercy. And grace, entry into the city where the gates are made with pearl. Grace, God's grace. This grace showed up in Abraham's life. Yes, it is in the Old Testament. Showed up when he believed God. And if you want grace to show up, all you have to do is believe God. That's all you have to do. Because without faith, it is impossible to please God. Abraham believed God. It was accounted to him for righteousness. He believed in God by faith. And it was counted to him for righteousness. Faith plus nothing else. He received God's promise of a son, and God counted it to him for righteousness. Not only did he promise him a son, but he promised him that the Gentiles would be included in this promise. That's a promise made, and we are evidence. That's a promise kept. Paul knew well this promise of God, a promise that could never be changed. And so he brings it to place now to defend, and place now to defend this group of Christians in Galatia against the false preaching of the Judaizers. He was so well equipped to help them to get back on track to defend the word of God. And he told them what they needed to do in order to fight against the false prophets. During the high COVID season, when we couldn't physically get together, Matoya wrote some letters. That's what Paul has done. He sent them a letter. He said, I can't get to you now in person, but I'm concerned about you. I care about you because you're going in the wrong direction. I fear for you. It seems like somebody has bewitched you, beguiled you, cast a spell on you because you so soon turned away from Jesus. Well, Matoya decided she better write some letters. She said, this is an emergency. Thousands of people were dying a day. They were putting bodies in refrigerators, throwing them in dumps, and nobody was calling for revival. There were no mass prayer services anywhere. Everybody was shut up by themselves, hoping it would soon be over so they could get back to business as usual. But Matoya sat down and wrote some letters to the people in this family that she loved, and she said, I would not want to die and leave not knowing that they don't know Jesus. She cared about them, and she acted on what she cared. That's a witness. She told them salvation is free. You don't have to work for it. You don't have to pray for it. You don't have to pay for it. God has given it to you. All you have to do is pick it up. It's a gift. Accept the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. Now, that's a witness. It's a witness of the gospel, and it's an expression of love. It's a defense of the gospel. She cared enough to intervene. And Paul cared enough about this flock of God to intervene, to get the strong word of God to them before it was too late. And that's what we're looking at today in chapter 3 of Galatians. Why am I belaboring Galatians? Because Galatians, the same thing that was going on in Galatia is going on over the world today. It's not in a little local place called Galatia. It's all over the world. I said to Carmi and Renee, I wondered why the Lord had led me to hang in there with John chapter 17. And I found out. I didn't know why, Louise, I didn't know why. I was loving it because I love anything that Jesus says. But I didn't know why, but I found out last night. I just went in to get a scripture from John 17. And then I went in to get a scripture on unity in the computer. And I saw in that listing something called the Unity Church. And right away, as a Christian, thought I to myself, this must really be all about the 17th chapter of John, because that's what I'm looking up. But much to my surprise, and what a revelation, I come across a church that is directly opposing John 17. Directly pulling apart the truth that Jesus himself put in that prayer. Directly refuting, directly nullifying, directly negating, and teaching it in a church. I said to you last week, they will take a little bit of the truth and wrap it around the lie, and people will eat it like candy. And so, I was called immediately to responsibility. So you can bet your bottom dollar, they're gonna get a letter. They need to get a letter. And not from me only, but I'm gonna send you the address. They need to get a letter to tell them that they can't do that to our God. He is I, and if they do it and we've told them they can't do it, the Lord will handle the rest. But we dare not know that this is going on and hold our peace. We've got to care enough to confront. That's what you've seen in the Bible, in the Sunday school lessons. Elijah confronting, Hezekiah confronting. You see them confronting, you see Nehemiah confronting. Because you can't be still when it's something that you know needs to be taken care of. To defend the word of God, to defend his reputation. No, Jesus did not say you could be in unity with him 24 hours a day just by thinking about him. No, he didn't say that. No. Jesus asked the Lord God Almighty, his Father, to make us one in him. One. Make us to be in complete unity with him. You can't divide one. You can't divide it. We've got to care enough to intervene in the lives of those we love. We've got to care enough about our Father God to intervene. We've got to care enough to really be his witnesses, to be his ambassadors, to be his servants. We've got to care. We've got to care. And so Paul shows us how we can care. These Galatians had been influenced by non-believing Jews in Christ, by those who preached another gospel, preaching the gospel of circumcision. And Jesus had said to them in the book of Matthew, you don't want me to heal a man on Sunday, but you're circumcising folks. You don't want me to do the work my Father sent me to do, but you're doing the work that you do to lead people astray. Do you know that this is happening all over the world today, as I said? Those who preached another gospel are proselytizing, and they are taking people out of the church, and they are following these people like the Pied Piper of Hamelin. They are skipping to his tune all over the world. This is called the Unity Church. And you've got the Church of Witchcraft. And you've got Satan churches all over the world. And you have the atheist church, and they have atheist commercials on TV now, where the atheist stands up proudly and said, come to my church and I will show you that you don't have to be saved by Jesus. That's an outright attack. That's an outright attack. And they are filling up because men are gullible and they will believe a lie before they will believe the church. Well, our children are going back into public schools. And where the enemy has a foothold, his emissaries will be everywhere because he knows that his time is short. So we've got to go on the defensive in prayer for our children and for our loved ones. And we've got to tell them don't agree with anybody who does not agree with God. Y'all know, somebody told me last week, said, your mothering comes out all the time. Well, it just has to. That's what I am. That's just what I am. We don't have anything to do with anybody. Don't listen to them. Don't listen to them. Don't agree with anybody that doesn't agree with God. The Bible says, have no fellowship with the unfruitful workers of darkness. That the psalmist tells us, don't sit with them. Don't stand with them. Don't talk with them, because you're vulnerable. The flesh is weak. Anything that goes into your ear can turn your mind. Paul, he says, don't compromise. Don't compromise. You got to know the word so you can avoid these people. All right. Paul didn't tell the Galatians. Well, you know, some of what they said is true. So let's come together on what we can agree on. You know what that is, don't you? It's called compromise. It's called compromise. It's called compromising the very word of God. It's called compromise. I love what you got on the screen. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree. Because he hung there, we don't have to. We've got to watch carefully. Don't compromise. He didn't tell them to compromise. But that did happen in 1990. My children are too young to remember it. Or they might have been dating or something then, you know. But Pastor and I were we were one of the churches that didn't go. They held what they called an ecumenical council. You heard of it. Ecumenicity is not in the will of the Lord. No. We don't have to hook up with other people of different faiths. If they don't have the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, we don't need to hook up with them in anything. We don't need to pray with them. Because God has not called us to pray with the ungodly. We can pray for them, but we don't need to pray with them. It happened in 1990, you can jot it down, look it up, when some Christian churches agreed with the Ecumenical Council that all of us should be, quote, tolerant, unquote, tolerant. Good old compromise conversation. They said we can agree on some things and disagree on others, but we'll meet in the middle on those things we agree on. That's compromise. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't shake hands with the devil. Write it down. Tell somebody else. Let us beware of those who are not like precious faith in Christ. Enemies of God cannot be your friends. Their one aim is to turn you from God. Billy Graham, you will remember, had a very good friend, and they walked for years together. They won many souls together. But when that friend went into the service or wherever he went, and he came back to Graham and he said, I found out that everything that you and I believe in is not true. And Billy testifies. He testifies. And you know how strong he was. He said that as he talked with him, he felt something changing in him. He said he immediately went out into the woods by himself with his Bible. And he said, Lord, I need your help. He said, because I know you are real. He went back out there and confirmed his faith. He came back and told his friend, you can do whatever you want to do, but I will not defect from the faith of Jesus Christ. He is the one who saved me. He is the one who keeps me. He is the one I'm preaching. That man died out of Christ because he believed that he knew best. They began to have, as I said, ecumenical prayer services where everybody prayed together. But the rule was this: you had to omit the prayer or the name of Jesus in your prayer. You could not call. They set the rules, and the other churches followed. That they were so happy to be called into these integrated groups, like the Jews in Galatia. And so they followed. We cannot compromise. We cannot compromise. Nothing is worth compromising the word of God. Paul says, I will not allow this church to compromise. The promise of God is true. Yes. And he lifts that promise, as I said, in chapter 3. He knew that the church had succumbed to flattery, the attention, the idea that the Jews wanted them to mingle with them, to be in assembly with them. They liked that. Paul was astonished that they turned away. He couldn't believe it. And he says in chapter 13, as he calls them to remember what they already knew, that God had made this promise to them. Abraham, Abraham, Abraham. You might be interested to know, and I'll try not to cram too much in, but it's difficult not to. But you ought to know that one of the reasons the Jews believe so much that Abraham was more important than Jesus is because there were several Torahs that had been written. And in one of them, it was not Jesus who went to heaven and sprinkled the blood, but it was Abraham. And so as you see how people, how the infiltration of false teaching can rob a church. So Paul says Abraham expressed the full faith when he willingly agreed with God to sacrifice his son. The full expression of his faith in God was proven then. How much are we willing to sacrifice to God? Ask yourself that question. For God, in expressing our faith in him, how much can we release to him of ourselves? How far can we carry on in the mission of God and for God by faith? We sing, "All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will gladly love and serve him, in his presence daily live." But if you test it out, most of us will have to admit that we failed that. Paul calls us in Romans 12, 1 and 2 to sacrifice our bodies, a living sacrifice, which is our reasonable service, that we might prove to the world what is that good and acceptable will of God. Be not conformed to the world, he said. That we might prove to the world what is that good and acceptable will of God. And here we are then looking at Paul's intervention in chapter 3. I will begin at verse 13, which Carmi read so well. Christ hath redeemed us. Christ, that makes a difference. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. Once he redeems us from the curse of the law, there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. Why, Paul says, he redeemed you so that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith, because Jesus Christ and the Spirit go together. You don't get one without the other. It is the regenerating power of the Holy Spirit that brings us into the body of Christ. Christ, Christ, Christ. He says, "Brethren, I speak after the manner of men." He's talking about the legal documents that we make. You make up a will, nobody can do anything with it. It's done. You make up a legal document, you can't break it. He says, nobody can break that, he says. So he says, "And I say that the covenant that was confirmed before God in Christ," we get nothing outside of Christ. We have to be in Christ to get the promises. "That it was confirmed before God in Christ. The law, which was 430 years after, cannot disannul that promise." It cannot make that promise of none effect. The promise still stands, and we can stand on it. We can stand on that promise. "For if the inheritance be of the law, it is no more promise, but God gave it to Abraham freely by promise. Because Abraham believed God, he received the promise." Paul asked them then, "Why are you serving the law?" And he goes on to tell them that to whom the promise was made, it was ordained by the angels in the hand of a mediator. And you know who the mediator is. Now, a mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is God is one. Listen to all of these theological truths that people just slide over. God is what told you that last Sunday. God is one. He's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Savior of us all. He asked, of course, a rhetorical question. We know that the law cannot be against the promise of God. Nothing can be against the promise of God. If there had been a law which could have given life, and we resolved that 3 weeks ago, because Paul told us in Romans 8 that the law of life in Jesus Christ, and it's a Bible verse, the law of life in Jesus Christ has freed us from the law of sin and death. We are free from sin and death. But the scripture, he says, has concluded all under sin, and we know that because we know that the promise of faith by Jesus Christ might be given in them that believe, because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But before faith came, we were shut up under the law. We waited, but we were shut up unto faith, where should afterward be revealed. And he says we are all, but after faith came, we are no longer under a schoolmaster, for we are all, verse 26, the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. By faith, for ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. We are his children right now. It is really then, when we get to the chapter 5, that we see the strong inroads that Judaism had made in this church. Paul argues them immediately, charges them immediately to have the backbone to stand against the horrific assault against the gift of freedom that God has given them in Christ Jesus. When Pastor Washington preached from this book, he said this. He said that church had become contaminated. It had become infected. It had been made sick by the intrusion of someone coming in, and by the church allowing them the privilege of preaching to them a false gospel. He said that will never happen in St. Timothy's. He calls them to stand and acknowledge the freedom that was clearly given to them in Christ Jesus. The reason he knew it was is because he had preached it to them. He had been with the church at least 3 times. And he says, stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free, and be not entangled again. Don't get caught up again. Don't get wrapped up again. Don't get tied up in the lies that have perpetrated this church. You're in bad shape now. In chapter 3, he makes it clear. And the Galatians knew this already. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ, you have put on Christ. That's 327. There's neither Jew nor Greek, neither bond nor free, neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ. And if you be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed. That's where I was going. And heirs according to the promise. As according to the promise, then are you Abraham's seed. Nobody can tell you that you are not Abraham's seed. Matwadi says that all the time. She says, I'm Abraham's daughter. And so in Galatians 5:13-18, he says, brethren, you have been called unto liberty. Only use not that liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. Now, I said you would see the mess that has come in, how awful this infiltration of false gospel has afflicted this church, because they have begun to bite and devour each other. They had begun to have physical fights. And you're saying that, sitting there and saying, oh, well, that was then. No. I don't want to point to somebody right here in our church who was in a church like that just last year. They walked in and it was already going on. And that's not the only one. When we went down to North Carolina, a charlatan had come into my uncle's church And he turned the church into a showpiece, and he was a comedian. And I mean, that church, Vashti, never had anybody like him in there. And he had moved all the humble people in the back, and all of his show people were up front. So it can happen if you let it. We've got to guard the faith. We've got to guard St. Timothy's. He says all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, and the word is love. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. But if you bite and devour one another, and you can look anywhere in your researching for this, they were actually biting and fighting and pushing and shoving and kicking each other out. They were acting like, one writer said, acting like wild beasts. And that's what you're reduced to when you don't believe the word of the Lord. Paul says this is happening with you because you don't understand the inner struggle. The flesh lusts against the spirit. He had been there. And the spirit against the flesh. And they are contrary one to another, so that they cannot do the things they would. They can't do what's right. But, Carmi talks about a divine but. But, if you be led of the Spirit, you are not under the law. Understand, you cannot help yourself. Jesus gave you the Holy Spirit. If you will be led by Him, not only will you stand, but you can convert the enemies or they will leave you alone. You have to be led by the Spirit. You can't lead yourself. You have to be led by God, the Holy Spirit. We have been made free. We are in that promise. We are covered by the covenant. We are covered by the blood. We are wrapped up in Jesus Christ. Don't let anybody do any unwrapping. We have liberty in Jesus Christ. Wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. We have been made free, saints. We have great and precious promises. And like the Galatian Christians, we have to stand firm. We have to stand. I told you last week, stand is a military word. It doesn't mean that you just stand there and look stupid. It doesn't mean that you just stand up and walk around and look like you're a Christian. It means that you stand firm on the word of God. It's an active standing. It means that you let them know that you don't play with my God. You don't come in my face talking about my God. You don't come in my church with that trashy gospel. You don't bring garbage to my people. We feed on the word of God. We have been made free in Christ. And because we've been made free in Christ, we can collect every promise He ever gave to us. I said at the beginning that I know there's some people here who have collected on that promise. There's no one in this church who has not received the promise of eternal life. That's a gift. It is the gift of God in Jesus Christ. There's nobody in here who has not received the gift of forgiveness. Every one of us have received that priceless gift. There's nobody in here, thank you, Jesus, who have not received the love of God, full portions of the love of God, the love of God that stands with you in dark times, love of God that takes you through the storm, the love of God that stands with you at the graveyard, the love of God that stands with you when nobody can help you. It's that love of God in Christ Jesus. Thank God for Jesus. I think about Donna Black. She received the promise. I think about Roberta Carter. She received the promise. I think about Ella Staten. She received the promise. She's got a new testimony. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living. Whatever men may say, I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer, and just the time I need Him, He's always near. We've got to stand firm. Got to stand firm. We've got to stand faithful. And we've got to be fruitful. As I close, 2 Peter tells us that these people who refute the truth of God are going to abound in these last days. He says, they know this. He says, the prophets said it, that in the last days, scoffers would come, walking after their own lust and saying, where is the promise of his coming? Where is that promise? Do y'all still believe that he's coming? Y'all think he's coming? Are you sure he's coming? Can you stand on that promise? Are you sure Jesus is coming? You say soon coming King, but are you really sure? Are you sure over here? Are you sure he's coming? Do you think Jesus is coming? Do you think anybody can stop him from coming? Hallelujah. They said he hasn't come yet. Well, he's got a good track record, Louise. He always arrives on time. He never late, always arrives on time. And one of these days, one of these nights, before he comes, Ralph, he's going to crack the clouds because he's got to come and carry us back with him. He ain't coming until he gets us out of the world. Are we sure of that? Are you sure of that? Judy, are you sure of that? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We can stand on that promise. And that's what we've got to tell the world. He is coming like a thief in the night. That's our business in the world, to stand firm, stand faithful, be fruitful in the mighty name of Jesus. Let us stand now for prayer. And I do know that we need prayer right here, right now. Because, yes, Jesus is coming. He's coming. He's coming. Out there in California where the fires are burning, they need to understand he's coming. Where the floods are rising, he's coming. Out in the West, I got to say this, where if you've ever watched the Trail of Tears, you would see the animals, you would see the Indians being pushed off of their land. And you would see them leaving their land and being backed up into non-fertile land. Land on which you could not make a living. And just this past week, Ralph, in those same spaces, I saw multitudes of people fleeing the flood, fleeing the flame. Jesus is coming, Matoya. He's coming. He's coming. And you know we can rejoice because Jesus saved us from the wrath of God. He saved us. So we're just waiting. Lord, I just thank you. I just thank you. We need to pray, children. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we lay these members of your flock before your throne of grace. And, Lord, we ask for complete healing. We ask you, Lord, even now, if you would just let them feel your presence. Feeling your presence makes us feel good. Father, knowing that you're here with us, because you said wherever two or three are gathered together in my name, you would be here in the midst. And I know you're here this morning. I know you're here, Lord. I know you're here. I know you're in our midst. And we welcome your presence, Lord. We love to know that you are near, that you are with us, that you are in us. Thank you. So, Father, now we pray, Lord, not for them only, but for Sister Eva Lewis. And we ask you, Father, in Jesus' name, that we will not neglect the care of this precious woman. We lift up Sister Eva Harris. We lift up, Lord, even Sister Marlene, who is here with us today. Sister Nicole, we lift up, oh God, Ray and all of those who have been and still are suffering with physical pain. We lift up Matoya before your throne of grace, Lord. And we're not just lifting up names, Father. We're asking you to work in them. We know you can. We know you can. We're lifting up Carl and Flora. We're lifting up Ivan. We're lifting up Mavis. These are our blessed members who are in grief, Lord. And only you, Lord, can help the grieving heart. We're lifting them up to you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We're asking you even now, as she was at a funeral, Mavis, yesterday, we're lifting her up right now, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We ask you, Father, to please move in Nicole, move in her, Lord. It's been a long time. Just move in her, Lord. Just move in her. Just move in her, Lord, and strengthen and keep her for every member, for every child, for every man, every woman. We are grateful to you, so grateful to you, because you've been mighty good to us, and we thank you. And now we pray, Father, in Jesus' name, that you would receive our thanksgiving, Lord. You've been so good to us. We don't take you for granted. You have brought me through this 1 year. You brought us through this 1 year. You brought us. We didn't bring ourselves. You kept us. We didn't keep ourselves. You communed with us. You accepted our tears and our grief. You accepted it. We thank you, Lord. But most of all, my Father, we collectively thank you. We thank you for Jesus. Oh, how we thank you for Jesus, Lord. He is our Lord and Savior. He is our Redeemer. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and thank God, with his stripes, we were healed. We thank you for him. And we ask you now as we leave this building, Lord, that you would bless us. Nobody can bless us like you do. And keep us, Lord. Keep us. Let the light of your countenance shine upon us. Be gracious unto us. Help us, Lord, to be gracious to one another. Oh God, in the name of Jesus and to his glory. How we love you, Lord. How we love you, Lord. In the name of Jesus and to his glory, we pray. Let us sing.
God bless you, saints. God bless you.